Well, that was one of my favorite hymns, or is one of my favorite hymns, looking full in the face of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's a wonderful hymn. It's one that I enjoy singing in my office there when I'm by myself. Nobody's around to hear how poorly I sing, but it's one that lifts up my heart. It's a wonderful fall Sunday morning. We are in fall, and I do see a lot of leaves falling, and trees are transitioning towards winter, and I think we'll feel that this coming week as the temperatures start to go down. I don't know about you, but I love the four seasons, and I know some of you folks can't wait to go to Florida when it starts getting chilly, and I understand that too, but we're glad you're here this beautiful Sunday morning. We're here to lift up and magnify the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, let's bow our heads and open our time together before James comes and leads us in a course from the past. This past Sunday, we had a course that we attempted to sing, one that we sang when we were younger, and I think Betty has another one for us that we're going to look at. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of being together as your people. What an awesome opportunity to just congregate together and to acknowledge that we belong to you and you belong to us. To acknowledge that we are your sons and daughters through faith in your Son. We thank you for his great redemptive work that he accomplished on the cross of Calvary. Lord, we're grateful that you have pulled us out of this world, even though we're still in it, yet we're not of it, and you set us apart. You separated us and called us to be your people, and now we are to be sojourners in this world and to be salt and to be light and to be your witnesses to those that are lost and perishing. So, Father, we're here on this Sunday morning to get charged up, to encourage our hearts, to remind ourselves of our calling, and to get our strength through the teaching of your word and through the fellowship that we have here in Christ. So we just ask that you would encourage us and just remind us who we are in Christ and help us to fulfill that calling for which you have called us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Wow, that chorus we sang was a chorus I hadn't sung, I don't think, since I had a cowlick on my forehead when I was a young lad. Boy, that was a long time ago. That's been many years since I heard that song. Yeah, thank you for choosing that. It's great to hear some of those old choruses. That's a long time ago. Well, please turn your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. The Apostle Paul paints a picture of a future society. It's a terrible picture of what the character of people will be like living in the last days of human history. The Apostle Paul says to young Timothy in verse 1, he says, "But know this, that the last days, perilous times will come." These last days will be filled with demonic activity. We talked about that in our last lesson. The word perilous is translated in Matthew's gospel in reference to Jesus dealing with demonic activity as exceedingly fierce, as exceedingly fierce. The world will face moral and spiritual and social and political breakdown. We are living in those days. That's what I believe. We're living in that aspect of last days that the Apostle Paul warned Timothy about so long ago. But we need not be afraid because the scriptures show us that God is in complete control. And we talked about that in our last lesson. We're not to be afraid of things that are taking place in our society because all of this has not escaped God's notice. God sees all things. He's omniscient and he's omnipotent and he's omnipresent. And he knows exactly what is happening in our culture. And all of it is leading up to his return. These last days, as they unfold, we are instructed by our Lord when he was here upon this earth. In Luke 21, verse 28, he says to look up and lift up your heads because your redemption draws nigh. Boy, I have that underlined in my Bible, in that section of Luke's gospel. To look up, lift up your heads because your redemption draws nigh. The older I get and the more these characteristics I see unfold in the newspapers and on television and I see it all over, I look up, I lift up my head because I know my redemption is drawing nigh. I know the Lord's return is coming soon. Well, in our previous lesson, we shared with you three exhortations. The first one was to know how the last days people will act around you. And we looked at verses 2 through 5, which gives us those characteristics. And it begins with this. For men, I have that underlined in my Bible. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people turn away. Well, in last week's lesson, we took a look at those 19 different characteristics of men that will be living in that day. Well, these are men that are living in this day. These are the characteristics of many men that are living today. And we touched on each one of them. And then secondly, I shared with you that we are to know the last day's people, how they will attack you. How will these people attack you? And we looked specifically at verse 6 and 7. For of this sort are those who creep into households and make captive of gullible women loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts. always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. These men that have these characteristics, these ungodly men with the characteristics that I just communicated to you through the words that Paul gave to Timothy here, these ungodly characteristics will infiltrate the home and will attack women, will attack women, will attack the entire home. And how sad to see a lot of that happening today. And then lastly, we considered the exhortation to know how the last days people will attract you, how they will attract you. And we saw this in verses 8 and 9. Now as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so do these who also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds disapproved concerning the faith, but they will progress no further, for their folly will be manifest to all, as theirs also was. In these last days, these false religious leaders will attract people through counterfeiting the Word of God. They will resist the truth by replacing it with falsehood, and they will do marvelous things to attract crowds. They will infiltrate the home and attract gullible people to their sensational teaching and their sensational attractions. On the outside, they will look very pious, but they will be filled with selfish, evil motives. And also, not only counterfeiting the Word of God, as we discussed in our last lesson, they will corrupt the minds of people. Instead of focusing on a theocentric mindset, a Christ-centered mindset, they will be egotistical in their pursuits. And their focus will be upon themselves, bringing to themselves wealth, bringing to themselves a following. And we see that. We see that in many of the religious pursuits of those that televise themselves and those that are building little empires for themselves. Satan is the great imitator and counterfeiter, as I shared with you in our last lesson. And many people and religious leaders in the last days will have a counterfeit faith. Their life ambition will be supplanting the Word of God with feeling good type promotions. There are preachers preaching this Sunday morning with feel good kind of stuff. They want you to feel good. Listen, you need to listen to the Word of God and what it says concerning you. And sometimes it does lift you up and make you feel good, but sometimes it convicts you to the core. Sometimes it makes you feel miserable because you know that you're not obeying its Word. These are the characteristics, and you better know them. Know how they will attack or act towards you, and know how they will attack you, and then know how they will attract you. Now, what do you do in response to all of this? This is where we get into the second part of this lesson, which we will conclude today. What do I do as a pastor, and what do I do as a father or a mother or as a grandparent? How do we teach our children? How do we face these days that the Bible describes as perilous times, as fierce times? Well, thank God we're not left to flounder. God has shown us precisely what we're to do. And that's exactly what I want to share with you this morning. And we find it pretty much in our text here that we've been springboarding from this last lesson, and also in the previous series that I've shared with you. The first point I want to share with you this morning is that we need to practice separation. We need to practice separation. It's something that's not taught pretty much anymore. Christians don't separate anymore. They stink as much as the world stinks, sadly to say. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. It speaks of those having a form of godliness, but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. Now, what does the Bible tell us to do? It says, from such people, turn away. Turn away. We are to turn away from such people. Now, what people are we to turn away from? We're to turn away from people who have a form of godliness, but deny its power. In other words, we're to turn away from Christians who are fakes. Christians who say, yes, I know God. Yes, I believe the Bible, but when you align their lives with what the scriptures teach, there's nothing to them. Their life is nothing but chaff. If you look with me to verse 10 and see what Paul writes there, but you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, and perseverance. What Paul is teaching Timothy is that we have to turn from some and we turn to others. I've done that all my life, especially as a young man. When I was young in the faith, there were people that I had to turn away from. I said, boy, I can't be around these people. They're not good at influence on my life. But then there were people that were godly, and I said to myself, John, you've got to spend more time with these people. You've got to turn from some and turn to others. Paul says those who are fakes, who have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, they're false Christians, you've got to turn away from them. But those who carefully follow my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, and love, and perseverance, those are the ones you got to hang around with. You know, when I was in Bible college, I was a little older because I had accomplished a couple of years of junior college. And when I transitioned into a Baptist Bible college, a lot of those kids were just out of high school. And they were pretty squirrely. And I said to myself, man, I'm past that. I've been saved a couple of years, and I really don't want to hang around these guys. Because I'm still young in the faith. And so the guys I hung around with were in seminary. Because why? Because they were more dedicated. They were more serious. They were further along in their faith. And I hung around them. And I'm glad I did, because it strengthened my faith. I didn't give up on some of those younger guys. They were only a couple of years younger than I was. I lived with them in the dorm until I moved out into an apartment on my own. But because I wanted to be used by the Lord, and I loved them, and you know, I was one of them, and they were brothers in Christ. But you need to turn from some, and you need to turn from others. You need to turn from the fakes, and you need to turn to those that are true. You are to separate yourself from people of this world, from worldliness. Yes, you're to be in the world, but you're not to be of the world, Jesus said. You say, Pastor, this brings us a problem. Sometimes you tell us that we're to have unsafe friends so that we can witness to them, and other times you're telling us now that we got to separate from them. There's a balance there that we have to have. I have unsafe friends. I've had unsafe friends all my life. My children grew up in Christian school, and I made sure that they had unsafe friends. Well, they actually had unsaved friends in Christian school, too, as well, because I knew good and well that some of those kids were not truly born again. But we need to have a balance. And so I want to explain some of that here with you this morning. There's a delicate balance here that we must have, that a believer must keep. And so let me talk to you about some of the kind of separation that I want us to focus upon here. I want to read six passages or verses that kind of hone us in on what I'm talking about today. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. You might want to mark it in your Bible. 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 14 and 15. And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note that person, and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. I got people like that in my life. I believe they're brothers, but I don't associate with them as buddy buddies. Romans chapter 16, verse 17. Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. I've known some over the years. They're very divisive. And those are dangerous people. And you need to avoid them. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 11. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner or even to eat with such a person. Scripture is very plain here. We need to be careful. 1 Timothy 6, verse 5, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means for gain. From such withdraw yourself. 2 John chapter 1, verse 10, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house or greet him. There's other scriptures I could have read to you this morning. We're to be cautious living in this world as we are to not be of this world. Yes, we're to associate with many of these people, but our association is to reach out with the gospel. I know people that are in some of these categories that are working to be overcomers. And I'm right there with them to encourage them to be overcomers. But those who have a form of godliness but deny its power, that just basically only have the name of Christ and could care less about anything else related to Christianity, they're fakes. They're frauds. They have no heart for God. They have no time for God. They're not really born again. They really don't have the name of Christ written upon them. They're just frauds. They're just frauds. And they're dangerous people. And you're to stay away from them as being buddy buddies or close friends. Yes, you're to try to build a bridge to reach out with the gospel, but that's as far as you go. I hope you're catching the drift of these verses and my conversation here. And many of these passages that I read to you here are not talking about unsaved people of this world. We're talking about the kind of people that claim to be Christians, that claim to be believers, that maybe attend church. We have people attending our churches across the land, Bible-believing churches, that really could care less about Christ or the Bible. But they come to church or they go to church out of tradition. I'm thankful that they're in church. But sadly to say, some of the pulpits today aren't preaching the Word of God. They're preaching feel-good messages. They're not preaching doctrine. And it's becoming more and more evident. But at the same time I say that, there are churches that are really preaching the gospel. And with power. And are confronting the societal sins of this last day's generation of people. Yes, we can love these people, and yes, we can witness to these people, and yes, we can spend time with these people if our purpose is in a loving way to bring them to repentance and bring them to the Lord. We want to see these people come to the Lord. But when we have people who are living in immorality, people who are living in apostasy, people who are doing wrong and they know they are doing wrong and they know we know they are doing wrong, and yet we have lovey-dovey fellowship with them like we just turn our face to the fact that they're doing wrong, we're doing them a grave disservice. And let me tell you, they are doing you a grave disservice. Because you, instead of helping them, they are hurting you. They're tearing you down. They're anesthetizing you to the strength that you're to have in your walk in this ungodly world in which we live. My friend, separation is necessary in these last days. You ought to treat people who are living lives of sexual immorality, people who are living lives of ungodliness, as you would treat people who are living with a dangerous disease. You've got to be careful. You know, anytime I go into the hospital for something, or even into a doctor's office, boy, they're putting on the latex gloves, and they're wearing masks. They're being careful. They're being careful. Let me tell you, there's sinners that I'm around with on a regular basis where spiritually I'm wearing latex gloves and I'm wearing not just a face mask, I'm wearing a shield, I'm almost wearing a body armor. The armor of God that I have on me. Because they're dangerous people. They carry dangerous diseases. But I love them. Because they're unsaved. Or I love them because they've fallen by the wayside. The world has gotten a hold of them and blinded their eyes. And I'm praying, I'm hoping that I can snatch them out of the fire before they burn, as the book of James says. I like reaching out to those that some believers have just given up on. I've seen some come back. I've seen some get saved who claimed they were saved because basically they weren't saved to begin with, or else they would have persevered. Be careful. You might catch something. Choose your friends according to the scriptures. You know, I have some good, godly friends. Good, godly friends. And those good, godly friends are, as I said, godly. Not perfect. I'm not perfect by any means. But we're to be godly friends to one another. And this is especially true for young people. In these last days, as always, teenagers should not date anyone they would not marry if they fell in love with. You date somebody that's not a Christian, not a believer, or a Christian who is not living as a believer, a counterfeit Christian, and you fall in love and you marry that individual, you're breaking God's law. Over the years, I've seen more young people dating unbelievers. They could care less about the standards of God's word. Maybe it's because they don't know the standards of God's word. Maybe their parents haven't communicated the standards of God's word. Because the fathers are characterized by the men at the beginning of chapter 3 here. As I read, men will be lovers of themselves and lovers of money and so on and so forth. Men in the last day will be weak, as I shared with you in the last lesson. So they're not bringing their children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord as it's assigned to fathers. Fathers today are dumping that on mothers. That's one of the greatest sins in America today. Weak fathers, wimpy fathers. And so we have young people here that don't know how to live, don't know how to make decisions. They can't be discerning. And so they grow up being unbelievers. Or if they are young believers, they're not discerning to know how to date. Parents, it's more important in these last days that you guard your children's company. My wife and I tried to guard our children's company as much as we possibly could. We worked hard at it. And we tried to let our home be a place of welcome and a place, a fun place to be. We tried to have some food and fun stuff in the home. And we tried to keep an eye on who our children were running around with. And let me tell you, it was a job. It was a job. But we didn't let our children just go anywhere and everywhere. Just like we were a bunch of pagans, because that violates the Word of God. That's the characteristic of a godless father, the kind of father that's described there in chapter 3 here of 2 Timothy. For men will be lovers of themselves. I don't want to be a lover of myself. I want to be a lover of my children. I want to be a lover of my wife, as God intended me to love my wife as Christ loved the church. Make sure your family is in church. In the last days, families will forsake the church. And boy, this pandemic has sure made it easy for families to forsake the church. It clearly commands in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, for us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more you see the day approaching. You know, I've read some articles where evangelical pastors are communicating that they're losing lots of people because they got comfortable not coming to church. They got comfortable listening to the messages online or not listening to them at all. They got comfortable having long weekends. They got comfortable just not living or associating with the church family. See, that's last days. That's last days. That's last days. You know, my family, We sought to be in church every Sunday. Of course, as a pastor, we were here every Sunday. But when I was a school administrator, we were in church every Sunday. We laid that discipline out for our family because we knew it was important to be under the teaching of the Word of God. We knew it was important to be in fellowship with God's people. We would take our children with us to visit the elderly. We would take our children with us to nursing homes. We'd take our children with us to visit our parents and our grandparents. And to this day, they want to visit their grandparents and visit the elderly. Today, young people really don't want to forget grandparents. And some of them forget parents. We need to be prepared for suffering. Take a look at verses 10 through 12. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance. Verse 11, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. I wonder how many in this auditorium believe verse 12. Verse 12, look at it again. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. You don't have to raise your hands, but how many of you have suffered persecution? I have. Of course, you're saying, well, Pastor, you are a pastor, so you no doubt have suffered persecution. Well, even before I was a pastor, I suffered persecution. I think it's worthy to talk about here a little bit. It says, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. If you're not suffering persecution, why not? Why are you not suffering persecution? Is it because there's no difference how you live than how the world lives? That's pretty characteristic of many Christians today. I'm not saying it of you necessarily, but the world is not seeing too much a difference between evangelical Christians today and themselves. Many who call themselves believers today stink as bad as the world does. And so why persecute somebody who looks just like you, smells just like you, or as dirty as just as you are? And maybe the persecution that they get is what, you call yourself a Christian and you do that, you say that, you act like that? That is a form of persecution, that's for sure. It's a form of mocking. You've heard the question, I know, a number of times, if you were arrested for being a believer or being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Ask yourself that this morning. Listen, the persecution that we're talking about isn't necessarily the kind of persecution where you get beat up or you get put in prison or they burn down your house or you even get put to death. That does take place in some countries around the world. Sometimes I pray, God, bring some of that persecution here in the United States. We need it. Separate the sheep from the goats so we can tell who are truly believers and who are those that are fake. The word persecution comes from the root word, which means to pursue. It means to scrutinize with the target to find fault, to criticize you. That's persecution. You say, Pastor, have you ever been persecuted? Yes, I have. As I said before, right after I was saved, I was persecuted. I stopped drinking. And my buddies at a conference we were at, in a hotel, half a dozen of them tied me down and poured whiskey down my throat because they wanted the old John back. And I fought them off. And I ended up having to move out of the apartment that I was in, living in with them. See, I had to change friends and select a new group of friends. It's called separation. I learned it pretty early in my Christian walk. You got to choose your friends wisely. Did I stay connected with those old buddies? Yeah, I did. But my connection was to reach out with the gospel, to share my testimony. I get persecuted 2 times. Yesterday and today, there's always going to be somebody that is going to criticize something that I said yesterday or something that I'm going to say today. Do you think that any godly person that takes a stand for what is right is going to make everybody happy? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. This book offends. The gospel is offensive. I've offended a lot of people over the years. And the older I get, I could care less. When I was younger, it bothered me a lot. But now that I've gotten older, hey, no problem. I still love you, buddy, but this is what God's word says, and I'm going to preach it and teach it. You're going to have to deal with it. And you better deal with it sooner or later, because the world's going to come to an end, and you're going to answer to a holy God. The way to escape persecution and criticism is to say nothing, do nothing, and be nothing. And we have a lot of people that call themselves Christians that basically say nothing, do nothing, and are nothing. That's who they are. In the last days, we need to practice separation. And we need to be prepared for suffering. And what does this mean? It means that as we live godly lives, you're going to suffer for it. It may be accusations. It may mean losing a job. I lost a job because of my Christianity, because of my testimony. That's happened to me before I entered the ministry. Paul communicated this remarkable testimony concerning the Lord's help for him during the suffering that he experienced. In verse 11, persecutions, afflictions, what happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra, what persecutions I endured, out of them the Lord delivered me. Well, let me tell you, the Lord's delivered me out of all that I have suffered. And I haven't suffered only a minutia of what Paul suffered. He was living in pretty difficult days of Christianity. Some people think if they live godly, they will escape persecution. Uh-uh. That's not the truth. If you live godly, you will suffer persecution. So if you don't live godly, then you're going to escape it. But if you're not going to live godly, then you need to ask yourself, are you truly genuine? Have you truly come to Christ? If you got that kind of wretched attitude. Listen, we need to prepare ourselves, our children. Teach your children to stand alone. Teach your children to bear the ridicule with a badge of honor. You need to teach them that the Lord is near and that they're precious to the Lord, because they're going to be mocked for their faith. You are going to be mocked for your faith. Well, thirdly here, and quickly, we need to pursue the scripture. We need to pursue the scripture. And this is a short point here because we've delved into this passage right here. Verse 13 and 17 through 17. But evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. We are being told in the Scriptures that the world is going to get worse. I would hope it would get better here. Maybe it will for a little while, but it's going to get worse. I read my Bible, it's going to get worse. My hope and prayer is that it will get better for a while, at least in my life and my grandchildren's life, but I don't think so. The Bible says it's going to get worse. It's not going to get better. Therefore, Scripture is so important in these last days. We need Scripture. It will be the handbook for endurance. It will be the handbook to endure these last days. We must pursue the Scriptures. God's Word is going to be your mainstay. It's going to be your handbook in the last days. And this has been my testimony. I was saved at the age of 19, and what has kept me going primarily is not how I felt as I walked my Christian life these last 19 years. It's not how I felt, but what I knew. And what I have known has come from the Word of God. What I've known has overruled what I felt. You see, you got to be in the Word of God. And so what does the Word of God do for you? Well, the Word of God helps you to endure. Take a look at verses 13 and 14 through 14, first part of it. But evil men and imposters, fakes, will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must what? Continue. But you must continue, which means to endure. Don't quit in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, Paul says, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ. Listen, there are all kinds of frauds out there, all kinds of evil people and seducers. I am talking about people who spiritually pursue you and your children with falsehoods and deceive you. The world's attacking you, they're attacking the home, and they're attacking your children. And if you look at 2 Timothy 4, verse 3 and 4, 2 Timothy 4, verse 3 and 4, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine according to their own desires, because they have itching ears. They will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. Now, who has the itching ears in this passage? The teachers? No. The hearers. They will give way, the passage says. Give me a teacher or a pastor who will tickle my ears. Congregations want their ears tickled. Give me a pastor or a teacher that tells me nice stories that make me feel good. I want to feel good. I don't want the Word of God. That's old stuff. I want to feel good about myself. They will turn away from the truth, because they want their ears tickled. They want to hear what they want to hear. They want to hear what they want to hear. And this is happening all over America today. Once our Bible-believing colleges and universities are, many of them have apostatized, meaning that they have gone away from the truth, or they're in the process of going away from the truth. And now some of them are the bastions of heresy. And some of the spiritual leaders in our country that once stood for the gospel, now they're caught up in the web of immorality, and what a sham their lives were or are now. But what does Paul say in verse 14 of chapter 3 here? But you must continue. You must endure in the things you have learned and been assured of. Secondly, the Word of God is our handbook for evangelizing. Verse 15, it says, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Nobody can be saved apart from the Word of God. Nobody. You can't be saved apart from the Word of God. How did I get saved? A pastor sat down and opened up the Word of God and shared it with me. In the last days, the gospel really won't be shared. It really won't be preached. And so people won't really be saved. Oh, they'll have congregations filled with all kinds of events that bring in people, but they won't be carrying their Bibles. Who needs a Bible? It'll be a lot of good, feel-good stuff. What are the marching orders for believers of Jesus Christ? It's evangelism. It's evangelism. It's winning people for Jesus Christ. The real proof as to whether you believe that we are living in the last days is this. What are you doing to warn people to flee the wrath to come? Are you sharing the gospel with anybody? Are you building bridges into anybody's life with the hope of sharing Christ with them? You know, the Word of God is also going to be our handbook for equipping. Verse 16 and 17, I'll read it. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. For what? For knowing what is right. For reproof. For knowing when you're wrong. For correction. For knowing how to get right. For instruction in righteousness, for knowing how to stay right, that the man of God may be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. Listen, those verses are, that's a military metaphor. I've shared that with you several times in the previous series, and I shared it with you last week. It's a military metaphor. We're in a war. And if you just want to sit in a pew and be a pew potato and kind of ignore you're in this war or bury your head in the sand, be one of those Christians or believers that have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, you are personally accountable to God for how you lived your life. You will stand before a holy God one day. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And I'm going to do my best. I'm not going to do it perfectly. But I'm going to try to be a man of God. I'm not going to be the wimp kind of a man that is described in the first part of 2 Timothy 3. We got a culture full of wimp kind of men. I want to be a man of God who's thoroughly equipped for every good work.
I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. And you're the one that guides my heart. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more, where grace is found, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need. My song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. It's powerful and it's living. And may the sword of God's word just pierce our hearts and do its surgery wherever it's needed. Thank you for its encouragement. Thank you for its exhortation, and may the Holy Spirit use it in whatever way he deems necessary this day, for Jesus' sake. Amen.